In last class, we are discussing about the key expansion is AES algorithm, right? In AES 128, we just saw how key generation has been done for different rounds. And we have been discussing about this temporary word generation also. So if you want a temporary word, for example, if I want to take a T4, this I is equal to 4, you will be taking I minus 1 word, that is W3, then this rot word. I think yesterday I forgot to mention what this rot word going to do. Rot word will, what it will do is, it will make a 1 byte shift. The shift will be in the left hand direction. Then we'll be going for a sub word. So sub word, I'll be using a sub byte table, right? Sub byte table, and I'll be substituting each and every byte with a table. Then I'll be XORing with a constant value which has been assigned for a particular round generation, right? So we just saw the constants and everything, and we end up with the example. So here I'll just help you to understand how this happens. So I need a cooperation from you guys also. So now I want everyone to note down the key. This is a cipher key which is going to be supplied, okay, for a AES 128. So since it is a AES 128, the cipher key size will be always 128 bit. If you are going with AES 192 or AES 256, the cipher key size will vary. Since we are taken AES 128 as a demo for discussion, here the cipher key size is 128 bit. So if you have taken this one as a cipher key, okay, you can able to represent this key as a word, that is word W0, W1, W2 and W3 are nothing but these words. This is nothing but your W0, this is your W1 and W2 and W3, and this key will be used for your pre-round transformation. So the pre-round transformation is nothing but simply the plain text will be taken and it will be XORed with this key. This key is nothing but your K0. Then only I'll be generating the keys for my rest of the rounds. Since we are discussing AES 128, we'll be having 10 rounds here, totally 10 rounds. So 10 keys from K1 to K10. So now we have to generate keys like W4, W5, W6 and W7. So I hope you people have noted down this cipher key. If you have noted down, kindly raise your hand. Okay. Because I want you people to help me. So now we want to generate next keys. So can you people tell me the values for W0? Can anyone unmute yourself from there?
24,
right?
Yes, sir. 24. 75.
A2.
B3.
B3. Okay, for W1.
34.
34.
34. Yes,
sir. Okay, 34.
75.
75.
56.
56. 88. 88.
Okay. For W2. 31.
31.
E2.
E2.
12. 12.
00. You're saying, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. For W3.
13.
13.
AA.
AA.
54.
54. 86. 86. Okay. Now we'll start off with generating the temporary word, because with that temporary word only you can able to generate W4. Once we get W4, then W5, W6 and W7 are easy. So to start off with T4. Okay. I need WI-1. So since here the I value is 4, WI-1 goes for W3, right? So this is the W3 expression we have, and now we are going to start the process of generating rot word. So I have to take W3, then I'm going to perform rot word. So guys, I want everyone to concentrate on this one, because this is worthy for 10 marks. Okay, first step after rotating, so I'll be getting WA 54 86, then 13. You can able to see this 13 has been shifted here. This is the output of dot one. Right. Now I have to go for a sub byte. That is after this process sub word. That is I'll be using my sub byte table to substitute these values. So I think I have uploaded the slides in the course page. Yeah, as of for now, I'll go back to the sub byte slide. Wait one second. So I want everyone to note on this one, WA 54, 86 and 30. So it will be easy for me to get the answer there. So kindly note down this WA 54, 86 and 30. Okay. Now I'm going for the sub byte table. This is a sub byte table. So we had WA, let's say 54, right? Am I right?
Yes, sir.
54, then 86.
86.
And
13.
13. So we are, yeah, thank you guys, thank you. So now we have to find the equivalent substitutional values for this one. So WA, we have to go here. So A and A, which will be replaced with AC, right? So AC, 54, 5 is here, 4 is here. This is 4, right? So this one, so 20. Then 86, 8 and 6, 44. So 44. Guys, during examination, kindly see whether you are using sub byte table or inverse sub byte. If you use inverse sub byte, the answer will go wrong. So it says 1 and 3. So 70. So AC 20, 44, 70. Kindly note down this value.
Yes.
AC 74, so AC is 20, 44 and 70. Right. So now we go back to the what's on. I want you people to tell me the answer for that. So after sub word, I'll be getting this one as AC, right? Hello.
Yes, sir.
AC then
20,
20,
44.
44,
70.
70. So this is the sub word we got. So this is sub word, and next one is we have to add the root constant. So root constant for this first round is here. You can even see the root constant table. Simply 01 and rest of things are 0. Right. So 01 00 00 00. Right. Now you have to XOR this one. Suppose. Yes, any doubt?
For W3, last one is 87, I think.
This is 87, huh?
Yes, sir.
Oh my God. Okay. Let's see. Yeah, it is 87, guys. Okay, 87 means this will be 87. So here the answer will change. So can anyone? Okay, I'll just put it to subtitle. So 87 means 8 and 7 is 17 here. So you have to XOR these two hexadecimal values. Both are hexadecimal values. So if you XOR this one, you'll be getting the value for your T4. Can anyone XOR these two and tell me the answer in the hexadecimal value in the chat box? XR these two values. This one and this one. You have to XR these two and kindly post the answer in the chat box. I mean, you can use your any internet calculators, also online calculators. Going to hexadecimal values. Once you found the answer, can you post it in chat box?
Out, take a lot out of that.
AD20177D. Okay, Kunal, we'll wait for someone's answer. If anyone got any other different answer, then let me know. Yeah, I think they are, the answer is here. AD201770. I think this is the answer you got, right? Yes. What your T4 to be? AD. AD201770. Now you got a temporary word. Now using you have to simply XOR. I hope you know. For W4, you have to take the temporary word. Simply XOR with your W0. So this is W0. For W5. You have to go with WI minus 4, which is nothing but your W1. XOR WI minus 1, which is W4. For W6, go with W5 XOR.
Sir, the screen has gone small, sir.
Small means?
Like it's coming in the small tab, sir, not in the full screen.
Sir, it's full screen only.
Okay. How many of you are getting in small screen? Can you raise your hand? I think only for few people the issue is happening. So. Only one. Kindly check, Shah.
So now it's over, sir.
Now it is fine. Okay. So for W6, W5 and W2, and for W7 we'll be going with W6 XOR with W3. So like this, if you XOR, you'll be getting the answers for this one. So I hope now you people are clear how a key is generated, right? If key generation is clear, can you raise your hand? If anyone have any other doubts, you can ask me. If it is clear, you can raise your hand. Fine. Okay. Now we go to the analysis part. So this is again another example. What they are trying to say here, in a sense, you can able to see here we have been given two cipher keys. And these cipher keys are going to be used to generate the round keys. And the only difference between these two keys are nothing but they are just different in one byte alone. Or simply saying one bit or one byte. So you can able to see they started generating the round keys. This is for the set 1, this is for set 2, that is using cipher key 1, this is cipher key 2. For p round transformation, they'll be using directly this one. So the bit difference is 1. Next, you can able to see the bit difference went for 2. But after round 2 keys, this is for round 1, round 2, you can able to see the bit difference started increasing. So the randomness do exist even if you are going to use 2. Keys only with the slight variations also. This is one of the weakness present in DES algorithm. If you have seen the previous class video, we have analyzed the weakness of DES. That is a key. Certain keys have a very major weakness if you're going with the DES algorithm. And also you can able to see, this is one of the most weakest key used to call all zeros or all F, that is highest value or all low value. Even if you use one of the weakest key also, you can able to see after round 3 onwards, okay, I can able to get a totally random keys into picture. So whatever the key you can able to choose, the AES will going to perform very well. But in DES algorithm, this is a major drawback. We can't use certain keys. They are called as weak keys or semi-weak keys, which can't be used in DES algorithm. Right. So these are some of the unique features of AES algorithms. And if you go for AES 192 and 256, how they are going to perform the key generation? This is only for your knowledge purpose. Yes, in the sense, they are going to group the words into 6 words per group. That is, they are going to generate first 6 words, and from this, they are going to generate rest of the thing. So whenever your I mod 6 is not equal to 0, there is going to simply XOR operation. When I mod 6 is equal to 0, then they are going for temporary word generation here. If you're going for AES 256, then the groups are made up of 8 words, that is from W0 to W7. And if it is I mod 8 is not equal to 0, they're going for a general XOR operation. If it is equal to 0, they go for a temporary one. But here, this is a unique point, which is one and only present in AES 256. Suppose in this, when I mod 4 is equal to 0, but I mod 8 is not equal to 0. That is, if it is a multiples of 4, but it's not a multiple of 8 means, then they are generating the particular keyword using a subword operation alone, XOR with WI minus 8. This is one of the unique step present in AES 257. This is only for your understanding purpose. In the examination point of view, you'll be getting numericals from AES 128 alone. So these are slight variations with respect to AES 192 and AES 256. Right. Move on to the structures. As I said, as we saw in DES algorithm also, they gave some alternative design. Similar way, they also gave an alternative design for AES algorithm also. Because you can able to see this is the original design of your AES algorithm. That is, this is a pre-round transformation. This is a pre-round. And from here onwards, your normal rounds start. Since we are discussing AES 128, totally you have 10 rounds here. And the decryption is totally inverse operation. So if this will be your pre-round, this will be a round 1, and this will be a round 10. And accordingly, keys will be used. And here you have to see one important thing. For example, if I take a round here, okay, you can able to see I have sub-byte, I have shift to row, then mixed column and add row key. But if you go for the inverse operation, this is the first operation because it is coming from bottom to top and this one is from top to bottom. So here the flow is this direction. First comes the shift to row, then comes the inverse sub-byte, then add row key, then mixed column. You can able to see these two are interchanged and these two are interchanged in the decryption part. Actually, this was the original design proposed. Then people started to ask, if you want to go for an inverse thing, directly we can, if I start with sub-byte, I can start with inverse sub-byte. If I go with shift rows, I can go with inverse shift rows. Mixed column, then inverse mixed column, then add row key, then add row key. Why can't you go for the direct inverse of this one? They said we can, it is also possible. It is also possible because AES algorithm, all the rounds are going to be non-PSL cipher rounds. So the non-PSL cipher rounds will always use components which have supporting only invertible property. So whatever the order you go, since it is going to support invertible property, these things are going to obey the rules. So they can able to interchange this also. That is, by interchanging, now you can able to see this is the alternative design. Sub-byte, shift row, mix column, add round key. We also go with exact inverse. Inverse sub-byte, inverse shift row, mix columns, and add round key. Right. So this is the alternative design they proposed for AES. And they also say that for key expansion, we can also design your own algorithm. You can use your own algorithm for key expansion. That is, they kept the key expansion part as a user-defined one. It is not mandatory that you have to use follow this rule alone. They say that if you want to use your own algorithm, you can also use, but under one condition. That is, if you're going with AES 128, the cipher key should be always 128 bit and the round key should be 128. If you go with the AES 192, again your cipher key should be 192 and your round key should be 128, and according to 256 and 128. This input and output should not change. Based on this condition, you can design your own algorithm to get these bits as output or key. So these are the some of the flexibilities available in AES algorithm. So anyone have any doubts so far, you can ask me. If it is clear, you can raise your hand. Okay, thank you. We will see certain example how the entire process will look like. This example will show you. We have a plain text, we have a cipher key, and using this, we are starting the operation. So this is a plain text, that is input state, and this is output state. So pre-round transformation, I'm just taking the round key, and I'm going to XOR with the input state. That is, input state is going to be XOR, and output is going to be given in the output state. for pre round transformation. So if you XOR 0 with 24, sorry. If you XOR 0 with this 24 round key, you are going to get answer as 24 round. Similarly, they XOR this 12 with 34 and they got 26 and so on. This is nothing but your input cipher key. You are W0, W1, W2 and W3 of the cipher key. Right. So this output will be input for my first round, and this is the round key generated for my K1, round key for round 1, and this is output. Output after all the operations of your mids column, sub bytes, shift rows, mids column and add round key. Like this it will be continued for 10 rounds and the final output is obtained here, which is ciphertext. And this one is a operation happening inside round 7. So this is the input for round 7 after sub byte, after shift row and after mids column. And this is the output state after adding the round key for the particular round 7. So my kind request, I want you people to try, it will take some time only, just try to do the entire operation once before you come for your CAT 2 or before your FAT. Because if you are able to do this one, then 200% you are going to get a 10 mark easily from this module. Because this entire operation lies on this one now, right? And for your information I am giving, there is a 1 hexadecimal value is error in this example. If you try to solve, you will be able to identify where the error occurs. Fine. This is for your homework kind of thing. You just try in your home. Okay. Suppose there is a situation. Like if suppose my plain text is all made up of zeros alone. So how much randomness it will be going to be there in the ciphertext? Using same cipher key and the plain text, you can able to see it's all zeros, but the ciphertext is totally a random output. This is also a unique feature of AES. Then we have avalanche effect. I hope everyone knows what is avalanche effect. We have seen the previous class video. So avalanche effect is nothing but if I have two plain texts which differ only with 1 bit difference and I'm using the same cipher key, okay, to get the ciphertext, it should be totally different ciphertext. You can able to see ciphertext generated for the plain text 1 is this one, and this is the ciphertext for the plain text 2. You can able to see they are totally having different bits. Also, you can able to see an example here. If you are using a cipher key, one of the weakest key as we said, okay, and this is the plain text, you can able to see the ciphertext also is totally a random bit. So these are the unique features of your AES algorithm. So with this, I am wrapping up for this AES algorithm topic. So anyone have any doubt in this AES, you can ask me. If it is clear, you can write. Yes, Vivek. Yes. Okay. Then I think I will proceed with the next topic. And next, what we are going to see is principles of PN sequence generation. We already had a brief introduction about what is a PN sequence number and what are the generations. That is, they have three different variants called two random generator, pseudo random generator, and pseudo random function. So, in this module, what we are going to discuss is how a pseudo random number generator can be designed using a symmetric key block ciphers. This pseudo random number generation will play a major role in creating the session keys from the master key. For example, just for your understanding, for key generation purpose, we'll be using this pseudo random generator. So you can able to build a pseudo random generator from your cryptographic algorithm itself, any symmetric key block ciphers itself. So there are two different approaches where you can able to design a PRMG using a block cipher. One is called counter mode, another one is called output feedback mode. So if you see a counter mode standard is called SP800/90, okay, and it's also called as X9.82, and output feedback mode also comes under X9.82, but here the mathematical expression changes. This is nothing but this is the output. This is the encryption process, because here we are going to use a cryptographic algorithm to get the random output. This is the encryption process, and this is nothing but the input here. In this counter mode, the input is nothing but a seed value, whereas here this is again the output, and this is the encryption process. And here you can able to see the input is nothing but the feedback of previous output x I minus 1. So pictorially, if you want to see, this will help you to understand clearly. The left hand side shows the counter mode. So initially I will be supplying with a seed value. So the seed value is going to be incremented I'm going to add bit 1 for each and every cycle. So I'm going to get XOR of 1 bit. So the seed value is kind of incremented with the value 1 for each and every cycle. And I'm going to use a key called K and any encryption algorithm. This encryption algorithm can be any of your block ciphers. Either you can go for your DES or AES or simple product ciphers, anything, but it should be a block cipher, right? And the output will be always a zero random bit. Whereas if we go for output feedback mode, I'm using the same key called K. I can use any of your block cipher, but the seed value is nothing but the feedback which is going to be obtained from the previous output. So initially I'll be supplying it one seed value. Then afterwards, the seed value is nothing but going to be changed from the previous output, which are going to get as a serial random bit. And this is a major two ways of generating a PRNG using block ciphers. So you can able to see the random bit sequence. I mean, there is a website called random.org where you can able to get the random numbers. This is the key going to be used. Either can be used for both counter mode as well as in the output feedback mode, and this is a seed value. Okay, and you can able to see the total number of 1 bits in this 256 bit seed value is 124. So it's almost 48% of the bits are 1 and 52% bits are 0. So it's almost equal to 50%, so it is satisfying the randomness property. I hope you remember the property which was discussed in module 2. So these are properties which has to be satisfied to get the, I mean, to call a sequence of number to be a random number, right? So using these two values they have tried to use in the output feedback mode, you can able to see the number of fraction of ones present in the bits: 57%, 51%, 47%, and this is nothing but the fraction of bits that match the preceding block. That is the previous output. If you compare the previous output and the present output, how much matching is there? Only 50% is matching is there. So around 50, 44, 48, 52 is matching. And the number of ones is also almost maintaining to be closer to 50%. And same way, if you go for counter mode also, they found it is almost equal to 50% here, and the matching also almost 50%. So this is how we can able to make use of block ciphers to generate PRNG. So among this technique, one of the most used standard is ANSI X9.17. This is one of the strongest PRNG specified in the standard, okay, which is used to generate a pseudo random output. And this PRNG generator uses triple TES for encryption purpose. That is going to use, these are DES algorithm. This is how they are expressed as EDE. This is your DES1, DES2 or DES3. Three DES algorithms are placed inside each other, and the output is nothing but your random output. So here you can able to see the serial random number have two inputs. Okay, one is a 64-bit representation of date and time. This is the one of the input. DT1 is nothing but your date and time. So obviously the input is going to be varying for each and every second or millisecond. So this is nothing but a 64-bit input. Okay, and other input is nothing but a seed value. This is a seed value. So two inputs are going to be given as a input for this entire block. Okay, then I'm going to supply with a pair of keys K1 and K2. Okay, and all, and as well as only two keys. Okay, fine. So we are using triple DES algorithm. I can able to see, sir, but you need three keys for them, right? So here they are using only pair of keys with 56 bit keys, which will be used for all these three algorithms. Can you able to see they are using all this pair for all these three algorithms, and the final output, okay, will be a pseudo random number. This is nothing but a pseudo random number. At the same time, I am getting the seed value for my next round also. So this VI plus 1 is nothing but the seed value going to be used for the next iteration, which will be given as input here. Then this is will be taken as a PN sequence value as a output. So anyone have any doubt in this part, in ANSI H9.17, you can ask. It is clear, raise your hands. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. This triple DES based ANSI, I think it is clear. Okay. This is clear version of this one. If you want to write it mathematically, how this output will be. So output RI is nothing but simply this DES, that is EDE of K1, K2, okay, and a combination of, you can able to see the seed value VI, which is going to be XOR with the output of this T of this one, and which will be going to be input given as input to this one, and this one, this EDE is based upon this TT1. For example, if you want to write it mathematically, I can write this output RI is nothing but EDE, right? EDE of K1 comma K2, that is this part which got this one, right? As well as it's a combination of VI XOR with, this is VI XOR with EDE of K1 comma K2, this is part K1 comma K2 and the input of DTI. This is nothing but the output, and this VI plus 1 is nothing but the value which you're going to get from this one, EDE of DTI and K1 K2 XORed with the output, which is nothing but the RI. This is nothing but the output, right? RI, and again K1 K2 of this ED1. And all this thing has been explained here, mathematical expression of the seed and your random output. So this is like a theoretical approach, it's just a concept, how a block cipher. Here in this case, I use triple DES algorithm, one of the strongest block cipher made PRNG. So I think with this, we'll wrap up today's session. Because in next class, we'll start moving towards the stream ciphers, modern stream ciphers. So anyone have any doubts in today's session, you can ask me.